The Lord be with you.
And also
I'm Pastor Dexter, and this is Pastor Liz, and we are so grateful to welcome you here to worship with us this Palm Sunday, if you could not tell from all the palms scattered throughout. Today is the day of Jesus' protest parade on a donkey into Jerusalem as people were chanting in solidarity with him, palm branches in hand. As we demonstrated today with the lighting of the Christ candle, Jesus, the light of the world, is indeed here among us, the family of faith, warming us and filling us with the power of the Holy Spirit. Longview Presbyterian is a community of faith that is seeking Christ's way and welcoming all people. And we're so glad to worship with you this morning. We have a handful of announcements this morning. First, a reminder that we will be celebrating the Feast of Communion later in the service. You'll have an option to come forward to take the elements, or you can also stay in your seats and raise your hand and we'll bring those to you. If you're worshiping with us online, we invite you to grab your elements so that you can participate in the feast as well. We invite you to join us this Thursday as we continue our Holy Week services for our Maundy Thursday service. That's this Thursday, April 6th at 7 p.m., right here in the sanctuary or online as usual. We'll have communion, we'll be singing hymns, we'll have a hand washing ritual, all to remember Jesus' Last Supper with his friends. Then we invite you to join us the next day, that's this Friday, April 7th at 7 p.m., either here or online, for our Good Friday service. Then on Sunday, we will be celebrating Easter. That's April 9th at 10 a.m., our normal worship time, for our celebratory Easter service. It should be a great service, and we'll also have a brunch afterwards. You can sign up to bring some items there, or you can surprise us with what you bring as well. But we hope you'll join us for that celebratory service. We have another important save the date for everyone with their calendars out right now. On April 13th at 5 p.m., that's a Thursday, not this Thursday, but the next, we're inviting everyone to attend the unveiling ceremony of the Victoria Freeman plaque at the Victoria Freeman Park. As you know and hear, many of Victoria Freeman's children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, great-great, and great-great-great grandchildren have worshiped, attended, and joined our church body, including one of our church elders over there and her daughter, and granddaughter. Ooh, that's right. Amen. We're celebrating with you all. But Victoria Freeman fought for civil rights in our town here in Longview, and she deserves to be recognized. So we hope that you will join us. That's April 13th at 5 p.m. at Victoria Freeman Park. Now, one more announcement. Today, we are inviting you to a welcome home party for Gabriel, our friend, right after church. Our LPC. Yeah, woo! Our families enjoyed getting to know Gabriel, Kristen, and their boys. And so today, we're going to have a celebration from after church until 1 p.m.-ish for a pizza party. That's right. There'll be an opportunity to hang out, get to know each other, eat some food. We'll hear from Gabriel a little bit about his story. And we're also going to be taking a love offering that will help Gabriel establish housing here in Longview. The pizza party will be in person. We haven't figured out how to do pizza through Zoom yet, but you are welcome to join us on Zoom to watch the festivities, and feel free to order pizza at home and join in that party. Everyone's welcome to attend. I now invite forward Pastor Sharon and Pastor Ron and Kay Naff and any kids who are here today to come forward to get us ready for the parade of palms that will lead Jesus into Jerusalem on this day.
Happy Palm Sunday, everyone. Does anyone need a palm branch that didn't get one? Wave them up, okay. So why do you think we have all these things? You don't know, huh? Well, a lot of us really didn't know until we were older, did we? But this is what happened when Jesus came into Jerusalem. This is what happened when Jesus came into Jerusalem. people were so happy to see him. They had a parade and they waved their palm branches and they even took off their coats and laid them down in front of Jesus. So today we're going to have a parade too. And we're going to sing Hosanna, because Hosanna is a happy word that means praise, happiness, joy. So Reverend Naff over here, Reverend Ron, Pastor Ron, and his wife Kay are going to help us learn how to sing Hosanna. And on our screen, we'd like to see the words we're going to be saying. Sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. And then we're going to say, shout Hosanna. And then we're going to say, dance Hosanna. And we're also going to have a parade. So we're going to be going around the outside of our sanctuary as we sing. And everyone is welcome to join, and you don't have to if you'd rather stay in your chair and just wave your palm branch. We know you're part of our parade. So, Reverend Ron and Kay, fast.
How many of you know the song, Give Me Oil in the Night?
We need to get you a microphone, Ron.
How many of you know the old song, Give Me Oil in My Lamp? Keep me burning. This is the chorus to that song. So we're just gonna sing the chorus, but I'm gonna have Noelle play it and I'll sing it. If you know it, sing it with us. And then we'll sing those verses as they are, two times each. I mean, we'll do sing, shout, dance, and then sing, shout, dance again as we go around the sanctuary. And then I'll just, when I'm done, she'll come to a stop and we're done. Okay. And if you don't come and dance around the sanctuary with us, you have to at least wave your palm branch. If not, you're kicked out of school. Okay. Go ahead and play it once.
We invite you to come down the center.
Sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna to the King. Okay, let's do that once more and then continue. Sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna to the King. Shout Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna to the King. Shout Hosanna to the King of Kings. Shout Hosanna to the King. Dance Hosanna to the King of Kings. Dance Hosanna to the King. Thank you.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. All right. Woo. Oh, wow. Each week, as we've been ruminating on this theme of seeking during this Lenten season, we've been adding a different layer to our Lenten symbol that's supposed to help us connect to this idea of seeking God on the journey towards the cross. You can see this progressively complexifying symbol on our big screen in church, or you can see it on your screen at home. Now we're going to have Megan Gillespie from the Zoom desk tell us about this next layer of our Lenten symbol today. Take it away, Megan.
All right. So this week we add a star. The star references a couple of stories that take place under the veil of night. Nicodemus finds and questions Jesus at night. Mary comes to the tomb while it is still dark. The star also represents the glistening of recognition in one's eye. On this Palm Sunday, let us hold a moment of silence to consider how we are like Nicodemus, asking big questions about who Jesus is as he rides into Jerusalem on a donkey. Let us consider how we are like Mary, watching along with the crowds as they celebrate Jesus coming into Jerusalem, even as the grief of the tomb lies ahead. And let us consider the ways we do and do not recognize Jesus when he comes to us throughout the course of our lives.
Amen. I now invite Kate Harlan forward to lead us in our call to worship, which you'll find printed in your bulletin.
Join me now for our call to worship. Where is he going? Isn't he from Nazareth? Can anything good come from Nazareth? Is he headed to Jerusalem? Do you think Jerusalem is safe?
Does he know that Pilate is here? Where is he going?
Does he know the city is dangerous? Does he see Rome's co-conspirators watching?
Is this the one we've been waiting for? Could this be the Messiah?
Where is he going? The crowds are singing Hosanna.
Should I lay down my cloak? Is this the beginning of the end?
Should we follow? Should we watch?
Should we sing Hosanna? Stay away.
He's on the move. Where is he going?
Listen. Where is he going?
Watch. Where is he going?
Stay close.
Where is he going? Sing Hosanna.
Hosanna.
Amen. I now invite you to rise in body or spirit for our opening hymn, number 196, All Glory, Laud, and Honor.
Israel.
may take or keep your seats. For today's prayer of confession, we are going to read the Palm Sunday story together, which Pastor Liz will be preaching about later this service. As we read through the story, we will pause to admit the places where we so often and so easily could change the narrative. Due to the length, we did not include all of the pastor's words in the bulletin, so I will indicate when you, the congregation, should speak the words in bold. So now, read with me from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21, as a prayer of confession. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there, with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." We say together, God, forgive us for the times when we do not trust your word and do not lead where you lead. We long to be the ones who can go into the village ahead of you. Forgive us when we play it safe. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And we say together, God, forgive us for forgetting that you are always coming toward us. You are drawing near like a king on a donkey. Help us find you in our midst. The disciples went and did as Jesus instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Now we say together, Creator God, forgive us for the moments when we choose greed over generosity, or when we choose our self-image over our loyalty to you. Give us the courage to be unabashed in our faith. Give us the strength to throw our coats on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. And we say together, Son of David, give us the conviction to shout your name from the rooftop. Give us the wisdom to sing Hosanna. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, Who is this? The crowds answered, This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. As together we say, with hope in our hearts, we pray to you, Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. Amen. Family of faith, there will be days when we withhold our praise. There will be days when we dare not follow. There will be days when we ignore God's call, when we choose comfort over courage and ourselves over others. But even on those days, even on our worst days, we belong to God. So hear and believe the good news of the gospel. Nothing, nothing can separate us from the love of God. We are loved, we are forgiven, and we are sent out to serve. Hosanna, amen. Amen. It's time now to pass that peace of Christ on to one another. I invite you to use the words printed in your bulletin, or you can do the sign language that we've been practicing. The word for peace, you put two hands and you switch sides, and that means become, and you go down still. Become still, and two fists together with, and you point to the other person, you. And then if you want to return it, you take your thumb and your pinky and you point at yourself and the other person, and that means and also with you. So Longview Presbyterian Church, may the peace of Christ be with you. And also with you. Feel free to share that peace with your neighbors.
Peace, Nancy. Hey, everybody. Zoom world.
Surprise. Surprise. Be with you.
As we find our way back to our seats, I'll invite Kate forward to lead us in our prayer for illumination and the scripture reading.
Please join your hearts with mine in prayer. Holy God, sometimes it's hard to hear you over the hosannas. Sometimes it's hard to hear you over the noise of the city streets. Sometimes it's hard to hear you over our racing thoughts, our mental to-do lists, or our desire to fit in. Sometimes it is hard to hear you in this noisy world. So just as you stop traffic in Jerusalem, stop traffic here. Pause the rush. Open the gates. Dwell among us until your word is all we can hear. We are listening. We are laying down our cloaks. Amen. Our Old Testament reading today comes from Psalm 118, verses 1 to 2, and then 19 through 29. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, it is that time of year again in Jerusalem, the Passover. It's that celebration
of God freeing the Jewish people generations ago from an Egyptian empire that was enslaving them. It happens every year, and for the Roman politicians and police in particular, the current occupiers of the Jewish people during Jesus' ministry, it's a time when the Romans have always made sure to bulk up their shows of force to keep the resistance of the people at bay. After all, we wouldn't want the people they are oppressing remembering too much about the natural disasters God brought upon the military occupiers back in the day. And so, to show the people whose boss, as this resistance celebration unfolds in Jerusalem, the Romans conduct a military parade. Marcus J. Borg and John Dominic Crossan describe it as a visual panoply of imperial power. Cavalry on horses, foot soldiers, men on horses, leather armor, helmets, weapons, banners, golden eagles mounted on poles, sun glinting on metal and gold, the sound of marching feet, the creaking of leather, the clinking of bridles, the beating of drums, the swirling of dust, the eyes of silent onlookers, some curious, some awed, some fearful, and some resentful. And so Jesus, in response to this military parade happening at one end of the city, the kind of parade meant to intimidate a Jewish people who may want to resist the empire's power, he plans his own parade. Jesus plans a protest. Jesus plans a direct action that will be a parody, really a mocking of this aggressive display of Roman power. Instead of a horse, a war horse to ride on, he tells his fellow organizers to find him a mama donkey who still has her baby with her. Instead of swords and weaponry, they'll encourage the crowd to cut branches and wave them in the air. Instead of military banners, they'll lay their cloaks on the ground in front of Jesus. Instead of the sound of battle drums, it will be the sound of the people chanting, "Hosanna," which means save now. Save now. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. These are ancient words borrowed from a psalm traditionally used at Passover, the words of their ancestors calling upon their liberator to save them now. So instead of the empire's visual statement that weapons, violence, and social control will keep us safe, Jesus plans this protest, surrounding himself by ordinary people, banding together in resistance and solidarity. It's a counter statement that we, the common people united to care for each other, are the ones who keep us safe. This Palm Sunday parade is one of only a handful of stories that are found in all four Gospels. It happens right before Jesus is executed by the very same military might that is now on display to intimidate anyone trying to start a revolution. And as I hear the words again this morning, it feels to me like the last time Jesus and his friends can together make a clear public statement about what the kingdom of God is all about. As the writers at Enfleshed put it, in this direct action, this Palm Sunday protest parade, Jesus unveils what the empire intends to keep hidden. God alone saves, and God is among the people. To be a Christian, which is that odd word that literally means a little Christ, to be a Christian is to find our part in the Palm Sunday protest parades wherever we go. And there are opportunities all around every single day. There's a Palm Sunday protest parade happening today as folks in our presbytery go through prison security in Gig Harbor after being locked out of the prison for over a year so that they can go inside and share with our siblings at Hagar's Community Church the story of a rabbi whose first temple sermon was literally about setting prisoners free. There's a Palm Sunday protest parade every time we stand and speak in solidarity with trans kids who are fighting for the right to be seen and affirmed and safe in their schools. There is a Palm Sunday protest parade every time we say no to calling 911 for the police to put one of our beloved siblings in a cage, and instead invest in the kind of communities that take care of each other and freely share resources so that everybody has what they need to live. I love the question that the Reverend Ann Dunlap asks us about the crowd gathered around Jesus at this protest. Consider, she asks, where are you in this story? Hiding a donkey? Shouting in the street, asking what is going on? Feeding everybody afterward? Nodding in approval at Pilate's fine, shiny armor? Consider the crowds and let us be honest, she says. Where we find ourselves today is where we would have found ourselves then. So, friends, who are you in this gathered crowd of people? Which of the parades will you choose? Maybe this story is in all four Gospels to remind the earliest Christian communities and to remind us that there is no neutral place in the context of an empire. There are always two parades, one of systemic violence, of military might and force and social control and people in cages, and another marked by humility, of solidarity with the poor, of a long line of ancestors who worship a God who literally sets people free. This Palm Sunday parade asks each one of us, beloved, whose side will you be on? Amen. I invite you now to rise in body or spirit for our hymn of response, number 740 in your hymnals, Lead Me, Guide Me.
Guide me along the way, for
stand. You may take or keep your seats. We now have the exciting opportunity to welcome two new members to our church family. So I would like to invite forward Paul and Leanne Googins. Sorry to sort of put you on the spot. We'll just have you right up front here. Paul and Leanne have wished to join the church, and so we have a couple of questions for you, and then we'll have a question for the congregation, and then we will pray for you, Paul and Leanne. Does that sound all right? Okay, phew. All right. All right, some questions for you both. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? If so, say, I do. Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? If so, say, I do. Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? If so, say, I will. And will you be a faithful member of this congregation, sharing in its worship and ministry through your prayers and your gifts? If so, say, I will. And now a question for you, the congregation. Do you, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to be faithful members with Leanne and Paul, by word and deed, with love and prayer, encouraging and supporting them as faithful members of God's church? If so, enthusiastically say, we do.
We do.
That's pretty good. All right, Paul and Leanne, let me say a prayer for you. I invite people to raise out a hand for a spiritual laying on of hands if you would like to do so. Jesus, head of the body, watch over and protect Leanne and Paul as they officially enter this body of believers. Surround them with your love, your joy, and your peace, that all of us may grow closer to you because of this. Teach us to be good members with them and call us out into the world, sharing your light and your love. And all God's people said,
amen. Amen.
Paul and Leanne, you are now members of Longview Presbyterian Church. And whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus. We're so glad to have you here. Thanks everyone for clapping before I had to even tell you. That's great. Now we continue in worship in prayer, sharing our joys and concerns for us to be praying for one another. We invite you to send your, if you're online, to send a chat to through Zoom. If you have a prayer request, a reminder that you can always fill out this prayer sheet when you enter the sanctuary, or you can raise a hand and Pastor Liz will bring a microphone to you where you can say your prayer into the microphone. At the end of each prayer, the pastor will pray for you. We will say, God in your grace. And we invite all of you to respond. You receive our prayers, O God. Once we've had a time of prayer, we'll end with a prayer of silence for the prayer concerns that just feel too intimate to be shared publicly right now. We know that God receives those prayers, the deepest cries of our hearts. We begin by praying with John Steppert, a prayer of thanks for the Senate chaplain, Barry Black, who had a powerful and prophetic prayer offered, speaking truth to power before the U.S. Senate after the shooting in Nashville. He said he was tired of thoughts and prayers, and he also said, all that is necessary for evil to triumph is for good people to do nothing. So for this prophetic witness to the halls of power, Holy One, we say thank you. God, in your grace, receive our prayers, O God. Please raise your hand if you have a prayer request.
Hi, I'm Teresa. A few weeks ago, I asked for prayer because I was getting genetic testing to see if I would qualify for a new medication for the chronic illness I have that's genetic. And I am happy to say that the results came back positive, that I can take the medication. I have the genetic markers necessary for me to qualify. So yay! I will probably be starting it sometime early May. It still needs to go through a process through the formulary, but it's good.
Let's pray with Teresa. Holy One, we say thank you for good news. Good news that Teresa has been waiting for so long, that she qualifies to receive this treatment to address a medical issue that has plagued her for a long time. And we pray that as she starts this round of medication and this treatment, that it would be successful and effective, that it would help Teresa to feel like herself and fully restored. And we thank you that she's been willing to share this journey with this church family and that she would continue to reach out for support as she goes along this journey. God, in your grace.
Receive our prayers, O God. We also pray with John for the safety of our transgender siblings and their families and friends in the wake of all of the legislation happening nationally. We pray, Holy One, that the day will come quickly when peace, love, inclusion, and compassion will be strongly felt throughout the land like the waters that cover the sea. God, in your grace, receive our prayers, O God.
O God. Hi, my name is Cece Ragland, Cynthia's daughter. I was asking for prayer because my partner, his ex-wife died suddenly, and they have sons too that are 12 years old and 15, and we have to go to Corpus Christi, Texas, leaving out to bring them back and start. I mean, my kids are grown, so it's just like kind of starting over. But I ask for traveling mercies, please, as we're driving to Texas and the weather and everything, and for these boys to assimilate when we bring them back. The boys' names are Silas and Jude.
Holy One, we lift up prayers along with Cece for the entire family of Kenneth's ex-wife who has passed away. And especially for these kids, Silas and Jude, that you would bring them into a new place of safety and home with Cece and her family. And we pray especially for Cece and Kenneth as they make the long drive, the long journey to Texas. Keep them safe on the roads, on the highways and the byways. Shelter them with your mercy and allow the journey to be one that is filled with hope and with comfort. God, in your grace.
You receive our prayers, O God. And we pray with Robert Mumford for a couple that's been a great support of PFLAG in the Cowlitz-Wakayakum areas, Rick and Mary Ann Nelson. Rick continues to struggle with lymphoma cancer and is now beginning a new treatment. He's been through a lot over the last 3 to 4 years. And Mary Ann is, of course, feeling tired with all of the caregiving and constant treatment routines, even as she knows she needs to keep pushing and is praying for a treatment that works. They've both contributed so much to our community. Let us pray for them. Holy One, as Rick begins this new treatment, we pray that you would make it effective for his healing. Support him and Mary Ann with energy, resilience, and a community of care, and give Mary Ann everything she needs to continue in the arduous task of caregiving. God, in your grace, you receive our prayers, O God.
I'm Glenna, and I'd like prayers for all those who've been affected by the tornadoes in this country.
Yeah. Holy One, we pray with Glenna for all those whose homes and families and communities have been literally torn apart by tornadoes in this country. We pray for them in this time of terror and anxiety and trauma, that you would provide for all their physical needs, that you would shelter people literally and keep them safe, and that you would connect them to communities of care who can meet all their needs as they try to look towards rebuilding their lives. God, in your grace.
You receive our prayers, O God. We pray with Jennifer Langley for Andy's family as his mother is getting in her hospice care, is getting closer and closer to passing. It's been a heavy lift for all of them emotionally, spiritually, and physically as well, especially for Andy's father, but also for Andy and Jennifer and their whole family. So let us pray. Loving God, we ask that you surround Andy's mother as she moves closer and closer to you. Surround her with peace and freedom from all pain. And surround that whole family with your love and your grace as they are mourning and will continue to be in mourning for the loss that will weigh so heavily in their lives. Surround them with people who love them and will care for them, and with your hands that will hold them closely in this time. God, in your grace, receive our prayers.
I'm Robert Mumford, and I hate to monopolize prayer time, but apparently there's lots of things happening. A while ago, took our safe parking guest, Kat, to the court for what I thought was a citation for parking because of their trailer situation, et cetera, to kind of talk to the judge about that, only to find out that they had a court-appointed an attorney, which does not happen in citation issues usually. And so this week we met with the attorney. They were not just given a citation, but because they were unable to move their trailer quickly enough, the city of Longview has an ordinance that makes it a crime, not just a ticket, for people who park illegally. And she is having to face that crime. Thankfully, it sounds like we might be able to get the whole situation dismissed, but my prayer is that her attorney, as well as our efforts, Kat's and mine, that we'll be able to turn this thing over. And I am going to probably try to start something to say that particular thing in the city needs to go.
Holy One, we pray with Robert for our friends Chuck and Kat as they face an unjust law that makes them into criminals for trying to live. And we pray that you would work through their legal support and through Robert to overturn this situation so that they would not be criminalized for living in their trailer when they are just trying to survive. And we pray that you would support Robert and this whole community in changing laws so that we care for people instead of criminalize them. God, in your grace.
Receive our prayers, O God.
Did you have one too? Okay, we'll go Gary, Noel, and then Rob.
I'm Gary, and I just have a prayer of concern over the senseless rise in anti-Semitism that just seems to be engulfing the world. It's as if we don't learn from history, and we every couple of generations just start all over in all of these things that you would think you'd invent the wheel one time and be done, but it's very concerning.
Let's pray. God of justice, we pray for our Jewish siblings, especially this week. It should be a holy week, but instead Christians often utilize it as another path of violence towards our Jewish siblings. And we pray for safety. We pray for getting to the root of anti-Semitism in this country and rooting it out from that place so that this would be a country where everyone can feel safe in their identity. God, in your grace.
You receive our prayers, O God. We pray with Ron Naff, a prayer for peace and civility around our country while President Trump is going into court to face certain charges. So let us pray. Peaceful God, we know there's so much information and misinformation out there that not everyone knows exactly what's going on, and anger might be rising at different things that are happening. We ask that your peace would settle on this land and that your truth would win out and that your justice would be found in ways that provide repair for harm, not just punishment for harm. God, in your grace, receive our prayers, O God.
I'm Noelle, and a month ago I mentioned about a friend of mine who her and her husband decided to get a divorce. He is now on his way to Florida, moving to Florida. So he's left his little family behind. I do believe with events that have happened that this is the best thing, but It's a big adjustment for her, single mom, you know, all the stuff that comes with it. And I just want to lift her up in prayer, and just for guidance and courage and strength through it, because it hasn't hit her yet. And of course, but it might start hitting her now, being in that house alone. So,
Holy One, we pray with Noel for this dear friend whose life has been torn in two. We pray that as her ex-husband is now out of the house, that you would provide her with care and comfort when the reality of this begins to hit her, of looking forward at a life as a single mother. I pray that folks like Noelle and her entire community would circle around her and support so that she does not feel alone. God, in your grace.
You receive our prayers, O God.
I'm Ron. I'm one of the four, I think Liz mentioned, who will be going inside the walls of the Washington Correction Center for Women later today for what we hope will be a reunion. It's been 3 years since I've been inside. We call this congregation Hagar's Community Church, and that all three words were very intentionally chosen in discussion with our siblings incarcerated. And community is part of that. We envisioned the opportunity for a community among our incarcerated siblings, like the community that we enjoy here. And we saw it flourish over a year and a half or so, and then COVID, and then rules and administrative changes. And so there's a certain level of anxiety and nervousness that I'm feeling. And it's more, Gabriel, than just that I'm going inside the walls again. So I pray for a soothing and an invigorating presence of the Spirit among however many of our siblings signed up to come back and join us today for our first worship service.
Yeah. Let us pray for Hagar's and for Ron. Liberating Spirit, we ask that you would descend upon the women who have signed up to come to Hagar's and those who have not, that the rejuvenation of this community would continue to be a space of joy, a space of liberation for those women. As the church grew and grew in its initial years and overflowed its capacity, we know that this was a needed community of safety, of love, and support. So we pray that your peace and your joy and your grace would surround Ron and Haley and the others going in, that the women inside would be prepared to restart this community filled with love and grace, and that it would just be filled with blessings upon blessings as they regather again for the first time in way too long. God, in your grace,
you receive our prayers, O God.
I think we have one more, and then we have some Zoom ones.
I'm Janet. Last week, you prayed with me for the son of our friends, our good friends. Alex had gone missing. Alex was found. His friends didn't give up, and they went and they found him, and he's coming home tomorrow. Thank you.
God, no one is ever truly lost to you. And we say thank you that Alex has been found and is coming home. We say thank you for friends who embody your presence of never stopping their search for a beloved. And we pray that as Alex comes home, that he would find a place of rest, a safe place to process all that has happened,
and a reconnection to a community that loves him. God, in your grace.
You receive our prayers, O God. We have a prayer request on Zoom.
So the first one is from Merle, and he's saying, first of all, that he's sad that he can't be here in person for Gabriel's welcome home party, but is excited to be able to participate virtually. And then he wants to thank everyone for all their prayers and support for his recovery after his total knee surgery. Appreciation for all of my family who have helped in my care, Janice, Megan, Darcy, Julie, and Casey. Couldn't have done it without you. And then Julie has a follow-up on that one of prayers of appreciation and a feel of pride for her own team, team's care for Dad during his surgery. Their great skills and knowledge showed Mom and I, allowed Mom and her to relax because they knew he was being taken care of by the best, and also prayers of gratitude that he has done so well and is finally getting some relief from the extreme pain that he had been dealing with.
Thanks, Megan. Let us pray with Merle and for Merle. And Holy One, we give you thanks for the prayers of this congregation that have buoyed Merle as he had his operation. We thank you for, with Julie, for the medical team that provided such compassionate and loving care. We give you thanks for the people who have supported Merle and loved on him, especially his family, Jan, Darcy, Megan, Julie, and Casey, and their ongoing love and support. And we give you thanks for the option to have hybrid worship where people can continue to be a part of this community even when separated by distance. So Holy One, we ask that you would just surround Merle in his healing, that you would continue to watch over him, keeping him safe and healing his body so that he'll be able to rejoin us in person very soon. God, in your grace, receive our prayers, O God. Is there? We've got one more.
Yeah, I just had a quick one. I have a prayer of appreciation and gratitude for this community of believers who come together with such sensitivity for so many people in pain to lift them up and pray for their healing and their strength and their peace. So I'm just really grateful. Thank you.
Holy One, we pray with Carla a prayer of thanksgiving for the witness of Longview Presbyterian Church. 50 years of gathering around people with sensitivity and care and compassion for all those who are suffering and oppressed. We say thank you. God, in your grace.
You receive our prayers, O God. We'll now have a silent prayer time for us to lift up the prayer concerns on our heart that feel too vulnerable to be shared out loud. Let us pray. God, in your grace, you receive our prayers, O God, and we pray together to our parenting God as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Just like Jesus, who refused to abandon any neighbor in need, even in the midst of great stress, we hope to commit to one another with such fierce loyalty on days like today. We remember that what we have is meant to be shared. Let us be generous in heart and trust God's blessing upon this time of offering. Today, we have an opportunity to give financially to the work of Jesus through this church. We love God and we want to share that love with others. And we also recognize that we often give in ways other than financial. So you can take one of the little offering slips in your chair pocket and you can write down any gifts of time or talent that you gave this week and put it in the plate along with any financial gifts. We'll display those right here under the cross, a symbol of the ways that we follow Jesus in the way of self-giving love. And we have two special offerings today. So buckle up. I'm going to let you know what they're all about. The first one, which you got this last week, this pamphlet, and you got it again today. It's for the One Great Hour of Sharing, which is a special offering of the Presbyterian Church USA, our denomination. There are three programs that are supported by this special offering: Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, the Presbyterian Hunger Program, and Self-Development of People. And these programs of our denomination all work to serve individuals and communities in their time of need. You can give by putting your gift in the provided envelope, the light blue one. And you can give with cash or checks made out to LPC inside this envelope. That will make sure it gets to where it needs to go. You can also give online at longviewpress.org/giving in the special offerings line. And as usual on our Communion Sunday, you can also contribute to our Deacons Fund. The Deacons Fund is this pot of money we bring together as a church to make sure that people in emergency times of need have their needs provided for. And it's a great way for us to tangibly care for this entire church family. And part of that offering also goes to something called the Emergency Needs Grant, which is kind of like a Deacons Fund for the whole community that reaches everyone that are beyond the walls of our church. So thank you in advance for all the generous ways that you do give and that you will give today to support all of these critical and life-saving ministries. We invite you to give those gifts now as we enjoy an offertory from our church musician, Noel. saving one, you know what ails our hearts, our minds, our bodies. You know the pain and sorrow many are facing today. You know because you take on human flesh, and your spirit companions us in all things. For this gift and all your acts of compassion, we are grateful. May we all share with one another blessings to comfort each other, to sustain each other, and to nourish all of us as we labor for the good. Amen. I invite you now to join in singing our communion hymn, number 516, a different communion hymn today, For the Bread Which You Have Broken.
Take or keep your seats. We now invite Gary Schmouder forward, an ordained Presbyterian deacon, forward to the pulpit to call us to the table, a table where everyone is welcome, no exceptions.
Friends, you are invited to this table, people of every background, of every immigration status, of every sexual orientation, and gender identity, of every life journey, are invited to this table. As you can see by the non-perishable donations people have brought today to fill the blessing box, a 24-hour food pantry on our front lawn, this table is so full of welcome that the harvest spills out of our doors to feed our neighbors. This is God's table, and it is a table of grace.
Thank you, Gary. Join me now as we prepare to share this meal together with the words printed in your bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Join your hearts with mine in prayer. Joy is indeed the highest praise we can offer to you, steadfast love. On that first morning, you woke creation from its slumbering sleep to give light to chaos's shadows. You asked simply that we rejoice in your gifts and glory, but we chose to sing the choruses of sin and rebellion, following death as it paraded through the world. Prophets struggled to awaken our dulled ears with whispers of peace, but we laughed at their ideas that we should return to you.
You are holy, God our Creator, and blessed is Jesus Christ who comes in your grace. When he could have taken the easy way, Jesus chose to be faithful to you, even to the point of being executed by the state. As Jesus gathered up our brokenness to make us whole, you raised him to new life, and he stands with us in eternity, glorifying you forever.
Here at this table, we would receive the gifts of the bread and the cup, and your spirit which anoints us with peace. So nourish us with the bread of hope, that we might go into the brokenness of our world. Fill us with the cup of grace, so the weary would discover us standing by their side. Fill us with the overflowing joy of the good news, so we might sing forever of your heart's desire for justice and peace for all people, God in community, holy in one. Amen.
Amen. Beloved, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. They'll come from all over, from east and west, from north and south, from their landlines and their iPads and their laptops, to sit here at this table in God's kingdom family.
It's here at this table that we remember that our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night of his arrest by the police, he was just sitting around a table with his friends, having a meal, like we do so often. And that night at the meal, he took the bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it. And then he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat this. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me."
And then after dinner, still sitting with his friends, Jesus took the cup. He said to his friends and fellow organizers, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, which is shed for you, for the forgiveness of sin. Every single time you drink it, do so remembering me." Beloved, every single time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes again.
I now invite forward Clayton and Debbie, who will be help us serve the bread and the cup. These are two ordained elders at our church. Kay and Ron Knaff will serve as ushers for communion, dismissing people row by row to help us try and stay in a decent order. If you'd prefer not to receive communion, no problem. We invite you to stay in your seat for a time of quiet contemplation. But also, Debbie and myself will be wandering the sanctuary. If you'd like communion at your seat, just raise your hand and call us over, and we'll make sure to bring communion to you. If you're on Zoom, we invite you to be joining us in the feast from home. And we're going to hold on to our elements until we've all been served, so that we can then eat and drink together as one. Family of faith, the bread has been broken, the cup has been poured, which means the feast is ready. Let's enjoy it together.
Thank you.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. I now invite our ushers forward to collect the glass cups from communion as we hold a moment of reflective silence together, and then we'll move into prayer. Let us pray as the cups continue to be collected. God, who comes not with armies, but alongside the people, who rides not on a war horse, but on a mama donkey, nourish us with this food and drink that we might join you in your protest parade.
When we are scared of the cost of protesting empire, fill us with courage. When we feel alone in figuring out our role in the crowd, surround us with real community. Remind us that you have gone before us, and that because of this meal, we are never alone. Amen. Join me now in a unison affirmation of our faith on this Palm Sunday, which you will find in your bulletin. Join me in these collective words of response. We believe in a God who walks headfirst into the world's suffering, who lights a candle on the bleakest night, who pulls back the curtains so we can see the stars. We believe in a God who does not shy away from the truth, who is bold in seeking justice and humble in taking power. We believe in a God who sees our hurt and wraps love around it, cocooning us in hope, tethering us to one another. We believe in a God who is always carrying us from the pain of the world into the hope of a new day. That is where God is headed. That is where we follow. May it be so. Amen. I invite you to rise in body or spirit as we sing together our sending hymn, number 741, Guide My Feet.
Hold my
You may take or keep your seat. Thank you so much for joining us at Longview Presbyterian Church today for this Communion Sunday, this Palm Sunday. After the benediction, we'll enjoy a postlude from our church musician Noel as Darcy, our acolyte, will lead us with the light of Christ out of the sanctuary, a reminder that we are the light that goes out into the world. And don't forget, after church, there is a pizza party for Gabriel and Kristen and their family. Yay! So, I know you're hungry now that you've got a little taste of the communion bread, so please stick around. Dexter and I are going to be helping get things set up in the front of the sanctuary here, so those of you in the front, if you would kindly kind of find your way to the back so we can get everything set up, don't go anywhere. We'll let you know when all that is set up. You can grab some pizza and some snacks, come to the seats that we'll set up for you, and we will get the program started. And I know we've got an offering plate by the back door, and that is going to be the place for the love offering for Gabriel. You'll get a chance to give at the end of the event, but if you're headed home today and you can't stay for the party, you can leave your gift in that offering plate on the way out, this love offering for Gabriel and the family as they continue building their life together. And now we want you to receive this benediction, this word of blessing. As you leave this place, may God bless you with seeking. Seek out the hungry. Seek the weary. Seek the good in every person you pass. Seek out the hopeful. Seek the faithful. Seek God in every one of us. And as you seek and as you wonder, may you find what you are looking for. In the name of our loving God, who is always seeking us, go now in peace. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.